This was a very unusual, in many ways, a very unusual bubble in which a huge number of people, including retail investors, just started buying the same stock. And they were buying it because it was going up, not because anything really fundamental about the company changed. So this got started with a couple of posters on Wall Street Bets who believed there was sort of an arbitrage where they, since a lot of people were short the stock, if they began to buy it, they would drive the price up, and then the people who were short would have to cover, and it would drive it up further. So this was their idea, and it worked. So shorting stock is when I go ahead and borrow from my broker and I sell in the open market, and so then I owe the stock, and I'm hoping to buy it back cheaper later and capture the difference. So instead of buying then selling, I sell then buy. Well, you know, in the short run, there were a couple of large funds like Melvin Capital that were short GameStop for fundamental reasons, and it was really painful for them. In fact, they lost a couple billion dollars. I don't know how much of that they've made back in the subsequent drop. So in the short run, it was very painful, but in the medium run, I think these firms that were short were absolutely right. And the retail investor, the 600% rise is kind of a joke. And it's a kind of a trap that's going to suck people in who are going to buy at 400 and sell at 60 or 16. Well, the reality took hold. I mean, in some ways, this was an interesting phenomenon because it was such a meteoric rise. But in reality, these kind of bubbles have been happening for 500 years. And so people were buying it because it was going up, just like the tulip bubble. And eventually, you know, it didn't take very long for reality to take hold. You know, honestly, I don't think there are that many lessons. I think one lesson is that because of social media, these bubbles can get started and move with great ferocity, but I think they already knew that. So if anything, sadly, I think that hedge funds are going to look for these as opportunities that they can take advantage of this kind of crazy mispricing. So I think the lesson is that when these mispricings come up, they're going to jump in and take advantage of it. The thing is that like the market is extremely sophisticated, and so what's going on is that yes, a few like honest retail investors start this bubble, but then you get professional investors actually manipulating the bubble, manipulating Wall Street Bets, and a lot of the buying, you know, my students and I are trying to figure this out, a lot of the buying is actually institutional traders getting in there and driving it higher, knowing it's a bubble, but trying to take advantage of retail investors. So this is not purely a story of retail investors triumphing over institutions. Yeah, I mean, investing in these meme stocks is a great way to lose money. So if you're looking for entertainment, it's kind of, you know, if you want to buy a lottery ticket and maybe it goes up 10x, it's good entertainment. But people should just buy low-cost mutual funds and ETFs and not check them and don't stare at them. It's really, I mean, and I'm writing a bunch of papers on the media in their coverage of COVID and other topics. And the media is in the business of selling, you know, selling papers, selling stories. And that makes it an interesting story. If they just have a bunch of econ faculty come out and say, oh yeah, it's another bubble and it'll crash, that's not so interesting. So trying to pitch it as a David versus Goliath and people are sticking it to the hedge funds, that's a better sell, but it's not a very accurate sell.